quarter, so hopefully I'll be short and pretty presentation as well. Just a little bit about. So we did one study while I was at EU, and we found that diabetic patients do have more prevalence of dry eye. And I mean, this may be a reason, and they get a little bit as well. So you're very, very pushing and talk. Okay. These are my disclosures. I don't have anything to disclose regarding this presentation. Diabetes mellitus, I call it not a disease at the hospital. It's been talked about a lot. It actually affects every aspect of your every part of your body. Nearly 425 million people diabetic in the world. Pakistan is one of the 19 countries defined by International Diabetic Federation, Middle East and the North Africa region. 39 million people are diabetic in these 19 countries, and estimated that 67 million will be diabetic by 2040. People are living longer. There are better awareness. The diagnostic tools are better, so people are going to be diagnosed more. Every disease that goes for every disease. Along with that, health issues related to those diseases will be more prevalent as well. As we know, the diabetic retinopathy is the main reason for the blindness, but other aspects should never be ignored. Being a corneal person, I mean, I looked at the cornea, and we know that corneal endothelial cell loss has been reported in diabetic patients, leading to post-operative complications. But cataract, glaucoma, and infections should not be ignored. My talk is about cataract, so I'll talk about stick to cataract, mainly to the practical points. Age-related cataract remains the most common, and sometimes it progresses more rapidly in diabetics. Some reports, some studies have shown that posterior subcapsular cataract is frequently seen, and cataract can progress rapidly. And some, especially younger diabetic, and immunity has been reported in such cases. And cataract surgery in such cases needs proper planning. You just can't go and do cataract surgery as usual. You need to think and put things in prospect. Brief word about pathogenesis, I'm not again going into details. They've been suggested that there's a polyol pathway in which enzyme aldolipoproteinase catalyzes the reduction of glucose into sorbitol, and this increases the osmotic stress within the lens, leading to cataract formation. And autoimmunity, another proposed mechanism is that autoimmunity plays a role, and especially it happens within 3 months of starting insulin treatment, which obviously leads to poor elaboration. There have been some studies which indicated high incidence of cataract, like a beaver dam eye study. It suggested that incidence is poor and progress is rapid. Blue Mountain eye study showed that posterior subcapsular cataract is more prone in such cases, and Barnabas eye studies evaluated radiation of diabetes lens changes in 4,314 participants, and it showed that about 18% rise in diabetes. There was also one Wisconsin epidemiological study in which it was shown that 8 to 24% rise in cataract in diabetes, depending on their glycated hemoglobin level and also proteinuria. Overall, 2 to 5 times cases of cataracts in diabetics, which increases to 15 to 25 times in diabetics younger individual. How do we approach? Let's go to the practical points. Long ago, the approach was more towards the vision, but people used to wait and wait and wait and say, reduce vision to 2000, 2200, and then we do. Pollock et al. Suggested that the visual outcome was not very good. CNE, Sister Nakaradima, was responsible for reduced vision in most cases. But now there's good evidence that if we approach properly and if we do early cataract surgery, it will contribute to the visual outcome, a better visual outcome. It's also suggested that if surgery is done before any central retinal thickening or edema, there are less chances of post-operative really significant medical diagnosis. So you've got to make sure that you have seen and you examine the patient properly. In preoperative evaluation, as you do preoperative evaluation, you should do it. Along with that, you should note certain points. Number one is that, is cataract enough and it matches with the visual status of the patient? Or if cataract is not very advanced, but visual status is low, so you examine the retina properly. Cataract, what's I wrote in any book, so, yeah, just make sure that you see the patient from front to back, examine them properly, make sure that retina is there. Check IOP, intraocular pressure, chances of raise, don't miss that, do it yourself. We have had lots of blunders done by others and we can't rely on many. Pupil dilatation, pupil does not dilate. Again, neuropathy, this is Dr. Mustafa Negara, pupilopathy in diabetes is very common, pupil don't dilate. And we just keep putting drops in, and I've seen, well, in Alzheimer's and in other hospitals, that pupil is not dilated. It's a patient who cumulative pupil dilate. Drops, dilate, study your blood pressure, or pulse, hashal kiya hota hai. Don't do that. Three or four times you put drops in, maximum dilatation will be achieved. Don't keep putting drops in. So special instructions to the staff, don't keep putting drops, please. Hamare yahan phenylephrine use hota hai, and you know that phenylephrine can absorb into the system. And it was havoc. We did one study, 30 patients were reported, and we monitored them all, and the blood pressure was significantly raised. Local anesthesia patients go in iris margin should be checked for rugosis. Early rugosis to knee holding, capillaries to knee bundling. And if there is, then see the retina more carefully and also check for sugar levels as well. So if IOP is high, investigate and control that. If pupil is not dilating, make a note of that. So that when words come to you, you know that this pupil is not going to dilate well and you take precautions. Any rugosis noted should be treated first. Should be treated first. So do PRP and do anti-VEGF injections. Few scattered aneurysm and exudates may not need any specific treatment, especially if there's no retinal thickening in the central area. But larger aneurysms and exudates need treatment. So do PRP, do organ laser. Individual aneurysms should be treated, which are likely to leak or they're already leaking. Confirmed it with OSP and FFA. Don't do grid. Grid is out. Don't do grid. Individual aneurysms, please. If there's no macroretina, only focal laser may be suffice, but if there is clinically significant macroretina, anti-VEGF injection, and this should be done before. So if you strengthen the vascularity and if you reduce the thickness of the retina preoperative, it's been shown that postoperative results will be much better. But if there's a preoperative edema and you operate which increases the edema later on, it will be difficult to operate. So, your point. This, the first picture, I don't know if you see, shows rugosis, so that needs treatment before. Few aneurysms or hemorrhages here and there might not, the door picture. That picture on the top needs treatment beforehand, OCT and fluorescein there, and the other one needs PRP, and make sure that PRP is done properly and experimentally on anti-VEGF are injected. Choice of IOL, discuss in detail. Monofocal or toric if needed, probably better IOLs. Multifocal IOLs are available. I feel that they should be avoided in any macular lesion or likelihood of developing macropathology. There was a talk I given by me a while back where I said opacities, wherever there are opacities, don't use multifocal lenses, and that includes macropathy and some psychopathy as well, people who ask many questions. But also, multifocal lenses reduces contrast sensitivity. So try to avoid them if vision is already reduced, optic nerve is affected, and retinopathy is present. Surgery, try to do least traumatic surgery, minimize takeaway energy, run less fluid, and do not touch the iris. Try to avoid touching the iris. Now, what we do if pupil is not dilated? Matt, I mean, you listen to that. You, so I, he knows what I'm talking about. That's why I try to do it early. This is important, that don't leave the cataract for too long until it is so hard or so advanced that you can't operate to mid-dilated or half-dilated pupil. Pupil stretching should be avoided at all costs because it can increase postoperative inflammation and cause bleeding. And if there is if there's non-clearing vitreous hemorrhage, cataract should be done with retinal surgery. Postoperatively, in these patients, they may have worsening of retinopathy. The retinopathy was present before. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, especially metafenac, which converts into emfenac with an enzyme within the eye, is has been shown to cause reduced chances of CNA. Regular follow-ups and evaluation of macular thickness is important. And if macular edema still develops with all precautions, then that may be part of living gas syndrome. So just keep that in mind. Good diabetic control again. Post-operative uveitis can happen. PCO, some studies show that PCO rate is more in diabetics, but some shows there's no relevant worsening of existing retinopathy, so treat it preoperatively. Again, I've talked about CLE. Some macular edema may not be visible, so make sure that you do investigate. Many macular edema postoperatively actually settle, so you don't need aggressive treatment immediately. Many of our normal cataract patients will have some macular edema. If you do fluorescein angiogram, you see them, but they do settle, so no initial aggressive treatment. And in conclusion, I would say diabetic patients with advancing cataract do pose some challenges. Challenges are there, they have to face those challenges, and those who can face challenges are better surgeons. And this is why I say complications in Madhavari, complications go handle currency. And if you can handle complications, you're a better surgeon than other surgeons. Careful preoperative assessment is very important. Atraumatic surgical technique, and always be there and okay. I always tell them, please do exercise. Please do exercise. Please do exercise. Walk regularly. Cycling. Yes, it will certainly come up. And good luck. Thank you very much.